Good morning. If we have not met, I'm Vicar Christian, and I'm part of the pastoral staff here at American Lutheran Church. And so thank you for joining us on this wonderful Sunday morning. And thank you to everyone online who's joining us there as well. If you want to, you can go ahead and check in on your church app, or else we do have the welcome cards in front of you in the pews. You can check in there, or else you can also put your prayer request there as well. And then if you are looking for personal prayer today, we do have wonderful prayer warriors that would love to pray with you. They will be over there, available by the cross after the service. And then we are doing communion in our service today. And so you do not have to be a member of American Lutheran Church to receive Holy Communion with us. We just ask that you believe in Jesus Christ and confess that he is your Lord and Savior. And if you believe in that, then you can have communion with us. And so, buckle up, we do have a bunch of announcements to make this morning. And so if you can follow along on the inside cover of your bulletin. If you look there, there's a bunch of announcements. And so the first one is that today is the last Sunday to register for WOW. And so if you would like to participate in WOW, which is Wisdom or Woman of Wisdom, today is the last day to register. You can register out in the narthex. WOW starts on September 11th at 9 a.m. And then today and next Sunday is very, very important. We are having two congregational meetings. And so our congregational meeting today is going over our building expansion proposal. And so that will happen after our 10:30 service. And so we are expecting to start that meeting at 12 o'clock today. So if you have any questions or concerns about the building expansion, come. We will be going over all of that today at 12 o'clock. And then next week will be our congregational vote on the building expansion proposal. And so that is super important as well, because we will be voting as a church to see if we move forward with this building expansion. Please come, and this Sunday and next Sunday, childcare is available if you need childcare. And then on September 7th, which is this Saturday from 9 to 11, Pastor Mark will be offering some instruction and training for intercessory prayer. And this is for anyone who wants to deepen their understanding of prayers for others, and also for those who are interested in praying for others on our prayer team. And then on September 15th, Pastor Mark is leading a seminar called How to Respond to Social and Political Conversations. This will be on September 15th at 4 p.m. in the Fellowship Hall, and Pastor Mark will be teaching this on how to respond to social and political conversations as a Christian in this world. And then on September 23rd, on Monday, starting at 10 a.m. and at 6:30 p.m., Pastor Mark will be leading a series called Our Civilization Moment, which is by Oz Guinness. And so this is how we can prayfully and faithfully in our country pray for those. And so this will go for 3 Mondays in a row. And then on Sunday, September 22nd, Pastor Mark's uncle is coming to preach, and so we will be having 8 o'clock traditional service, a combined 9 o'clock contemporary service, and a 10:30 traditional service. So some of our service will be a little weird on that day, but then Pastor Joe will be here to teach about praise and healing, and then we will have a special service at 4 p.m. that afternoon. All right, and so this is our last announcement for this morning. We are having a Fall Fun Fest Festival, which is September 28th. It's the last Saturday of the month. It is from 3 to 6 p.m. It is not just for kids. It is for families of all ages. And this is a great way to show our community all the amazing ministries that we have here at American Lutheran Church. So we do need a bunch of volunteers. We are expecting anywhere from 200 to 300 people to participate in this Fall Fest. And so if you're interested in cleanup, helping the kitchen, running games, doing the welcome booth, there are sign-up sheets in the narthex and in the fellowship hall where you can sign up. And so let me pray for our service this morning. Heavenly Father, We are just so thankful for this wonderful day that you have blessed us with. We thank you that we get to come together in your name and worship you and just celebrate what Jesus Christ has done on the cross, where we receive forgiveness of sins and new life through what he has done. And so we just pray that you will open our hearts, you will open our minds and break down our walls, that we may encounter Jesus in a real way today through the liturgy, through worship, and through this message. And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. All right. At this time, I invite you to stand and greet those around you.
Some technical issues with the screen, so please follow along in your bulletin. We gather today in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
On this Labor Day, let us lift up all people who labor, either for pay or as volunteers, in jobs or at school, at home or in the workplace, here at home and all around the world. Let us pray. Patient Lord, you know us so well. We are fascinated by healing and can talk all day about the miracles, but we do not understand the compassion of Christ. We often say, just heal us, or just make me rich, or just make things go better at work, or other such deals, and then we promise our faithfulness and witness. But in our hearts, we just don't get it. Please forgive us, Lord, when our greed and fear get in the way of understanding. Help us to know the transformational power of your love. Get us ready to be faithful witnesses to you in all that we say and do. It is in Jesus' name that we now silently lift up our sins that burden our hearts and confess them to you. Amen. Hear the good news. Who is in a position to condemn us? Only Christ. And Christ died for us. Christ rose for us. Christ reigns in power for us. Christ prays for us. Believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven and set free by God's generous grace. Grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion and fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Please be seated. The first reading is from Deuteronomy chapter 4. Now, Israel, hear the decrees and laws I am about to teach you. Follow them so that you may live and may go in and take possession of the land the Lord, the God of your ancestors, is giving you. Do not add to what I command you, and do not subtract from it, but keep the commands of the Lord your God that I give you. Observe them carefully, for this will show your wisdom and understanding to the nations, who will hear about all these decrees and say, "Surely this great nation is a wise and understanding people." What other nation is so great as to have their gods near them, the way our Lord, our God, is near us whenever we pray to him? And what other nation is so great as to have such righteous decrees and laws as the body of laws I am setting before you today? Only be careful and watch yourselves closely so that you do not forget the things your eyes have seen or let them fade from your heart as long as you live. Teach them to your children and to their children after them. The second reading is from James chapter 1. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. Please stand for the gospel.
Thank you.
Holy Gospel according to Mark, the 7th chapter. The Pharisees and some of the teachers of the law who had come from Jerusalem gathered around Jesus and saw some of his disciples eating food with hands that were defiled, that is, unwashed. The Pharisees and all the Jews do not eat unless they give their hands a ceremonial washing, holding to the traditions of the elders. When they come from the marketplace, they do not eat unless they wash, and they observe many other traditions, such as the washing of cups, pitchers, and kettles. So the Pharisees and the teachers of the law asked Jesus, "Why don't your disciples live according to the tradition of the elders instead of eating their food with defiled hands?" He replied, "Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites, as it is written, 'These people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules. You have let go of the commands of God and are holding on to human traditions.'" And he continued, "You have a fine way of setting aside the commands of God in order to observe your own traditions. For Moses said, 'Honor your father and mother,' and anyone who curses their father or mother is to be put to death. But you say that if anyone declares that what might have been used to help their father or mother is korban, that is, devoted to God, then you no longer let them do anything for their father or mother. Thus, you nullify the word of God by your tradition that you have handed down. And you do many things like that." Again, Jesus called the crowd to him and said, "Listen to me, everyone, and understand this. Nothing outside a person can defile them by going into them. Rather, it is what comes out of a person that defiles them. Anyone who has ears to hear ought to hear." After he had left the crowd and entered the house, his disciples asked him about this parable. "Are you so dull?" he asked. "Don't you see that nothing that enters a person from the outside can defile them? For it doesn't go into their hearts, but into their stomach, and then out of the body." In saying this, Jesus declared all foods clean. He went on, "What comes out of a person is what defiles them. For it is written, 'For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come: sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evil come from inside and defile a person.'" The Gospel of the Lord. All right, you may be seated. All right, grace and peace you from God our Father and Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. And so, today we have this wonderful gospel reading, and it's actually a very important scene in the ministry of Jesus. But sometimes when we read the Gospels, we are quick to glance over the story and we just quickly move on. So I want to see something. Like, for instance, this story, is it anyone's favorite stories found in the Gospel at all? Like, raise your hand, right? That's what I thought. Is it not in anyone's top 5 or top 10 stories of Jesus, right? And I think the reason for this is because this story doesn't have Jesus performing a miracle. Jesus doesn't walk in water. Jesus doesn't feed 5,000 people. He doesn't raise someone from the dead. He's not healing people from their sicknesses. He's not casting out demons. It's not a story where Jesus teaches his greatest lessons, which is found in his greatest sermon, which is the Sermon on the Mount. It's not about Jesus teaching in parables, which we just spent all summer in. And so, why is this story so important, in my opinion? This story is more than just the disciples not washing their hands, right? If you ask me, I personally believe the Pharisees might be onto something. The disciples should be washing their hands before they eat, right? That's just simple hygiene. Like, I know the disciples are a bunch of misfits that Jesus put together, but come on. My youth group, if they can do it, the disciples can do it. But very much, this story is super, super important. This story is much more than just the washing of hands before eating a meal. There's a way deeper meaning to this ceremonial washing. It's a story that actually plays a pivotal role in our understanding of what it means to have faith in Jesus and how we overcome sin in our lives. And in my personal opinion, this story actually creates the foundation for our understanding of righteousness and being transformed by Jesus Christ through faith in Jesus Christ. And so, hopefully this morning, you'll understand the importance of this story and how important it is for our foundation as disciples of Jesus. And so as we begin to dive into this gospel, what we find is actually a theological battle between Jesus, the Pharisees, and the scribes. And so the first thing we're going to do is look at this theological battle, and we're going to build some context so we can understand what they are actually battling about. And at the heart of this battle is this. It is the understanding of being clean and unclean. And so these are the two dynamics that they are arguing about. And the first is, how does someone become clean? Or how does someone become righteous in the eyes of God? And then the second dynamic that we see is, what makes you unclean? Or what makes you unrighteous in the eyes of God? Or another way that we find it in this story is, what defiles a person? So this is what Jesus, the Pharisees, and the scribes, this is what they are arguing about. And so the first thing that we need to do to understand this theological battle is, what is righteousness? Right? What is righteousness? And so I'm not going to bore you with fancy talk or confusing theological words and stuff, but the simple understanding of righteousness is this. It is to have a right relationship with God, right? Righteousness means to have a right relationship with God. Righteousness is behavior that is morally right and is justifiable in God's eyes, right? So are you doing the right things according to the standards of God? And the standard of God is the law of God. And so if you are a righteous person, you're fulfilling the expectations and living according to God's standards. And because of this, you are living in a right relationship with God. Whereas an unrighteous person is breaking the expectations of God and not living according to the standards that God has for you. You are living an immoral life. And because of this, you do not have a right relationship with God. Right? Your life goes against the expectations and the standards that God has for us. And as we continue to build context for the story, there are two opposing groups who are battling Jesus. The first is the Pharisees. The Pharisees, they're the middle-class business and leaders of the synagogues. They were influential religious people who were very important during the time of Jesus. And one of the most important thing to know about the Pharisees was that they teach that all Jews should obey 613 laws that is found in the Torah. All 613. Now, if you believe you can do that, then you're doing pretty good in life. And then you have the other group, the scribes. They were men who studied the law, and they transcribed it, and they wrote commentaries on the law. And so these men were very important as well in the time of Jesus. And so the next question we need to ask is, what is the law? So for Jews, it meant the first 10 commandments that God gave to Moses, and it also meant the first 5 books of the Old Testament, which the Jews, they call the Torah, and what we call the Pentateuch as Christians. And so something happened very importantly after the exile. So the role of the scribes after the exile was expanded. No longer were they just interpreting scripture, but they started adding man-made traditions to the law of God. They started adding man-made traditions to the Torah. And it got to the point where the regulations and the traditions that the scribes added actually became more important than the law of God itself. And so when we look at this story, one of the traditions that the scribes added was this ceremonial hand washing before eating. This hand washing was not for hygienic purposes, but it was for ceremonial cleanliness. They believed that Jews needed to go through a ceremonial hand washing because throughout their day, throughout their daily interactions, they could have come into contact with someone or something that was unclean. And so, for instance, there were certain animals that were unclean. A woman after childbirth was considered unclean. A leper was considered unclean. Anyone who touched a dead body was unclean. A Gentile was unclean. A Gentile, or the food that a Gentile touched, was considered unclean. And so, if you came into contact with any of these things, you were considered unclean as a Jew. And so, these scribes put in this tradition where you had to go through a ceremonial hand washing to be considered clean or pure in the eyes of God. So what we see in this story is that the Pharisees and the scribes, they've been trying to get Jesus throughout the gospel, but they haven't been able to get him. And so they switch up their tactics and they go after his disciples this time. They go to Jesus and complain to him, "Why are your disciples eating with hands that are defiled? Why are they eating with unwashed hands? They are unclean." The law, right, the human law requires them to go and clean themselves, go through the ceremonial hand washing, but they didn't do that. And so, this is extremely, extremely important to note this morning. Because what lies deeper within the theology of the Pharisees and the scribes is that the rules and regulations and these traditions is what they saw as the essence of their religion. Let me say that again. The rules, the regulations, and the traditions for the Pharisees and the scribes was the essence of their religion. And so when I use the word religion today, that's what I'm going to mean. And so if somebody wanted to please God, they had to observe all of these rules, regulations, and traditions that was passed down from them through the scribes. And so if you didn't follow them, you're sinning and you were unrighteous. And what made you unclean and what defiled you as a person was from the outside. So once again, for example, if you were eating unclean animals or touching unclean people, you were unclean. You were defiled as a person. And so this was the theological stance that the Pharisees and the scribes had. So when it comes to being clean and unclean, so for a person to be clean or to be righteous in the eyes of God, they had to obey God's laws, but also obey all the traditions, the rituals that the scribes had created. And this really bothered Jesus. Jesus did not okay this. He did not like this whatsoever. The fact that the Pharisees and the scribes considered their human laws on the same level as God's laws bothered Jesus, and it was not okay. And this was the first problem that Jesus had with them. The rules, the regulations, and the traditions that the scribes created for the Jews to obey, Jesus was not okay with. They are not equal to God's law. They are not equal to what God has commanded his people. And at times, these human laws were even being elevated above God's laws. And we see this where Jesus is arguing in verses 9 through 13 that these human laws were actually restricting the Jews from obeying God's commands. And then the second problem, and what I believe to be the bigger problem overall, is that ultimately at the heart of this theology for the Pharisees and the scribes is what we call legalism. Right? Legalism is this, the idea of dependence on moral law for righteousness and justification. Right? Legalism is the idea of dependence on moral law for righteousness and justification. And you might be asking yourself right now, well, why is legalism bad? And that is a great question. Legalism actually leads to hypocrisy. Right? Legalism leads to hypocrisy. Look at what Jesus says when he responds to the Pharisees and the scribes. Jesus says, "Isaiah was right when he prophesied about you hypocrites. As it is written, these people honor me with their lips, but their hearts are far from me. They worship me in vain. Their teachings are merely human rules." All right, so being a hypocrite and living in hypocrisy is actually a very dangerous thing to do. And so for me to explain this, we are going to have some fun. We're going to nerd out a little bit for the next couple of minutes. And so when I love doing these deeper understandings, these deeper dives into these Greek words, because the Greek word for hypocrite is hypocrites. See, so it's difficult for me to pronounce as well. But in today's culture, the word hypocrite is used to define someone claiming to have moral standards or beliefs to which they do not behave or conform to. But in ancient Greece, the word hypocrite was used to describe someone who was a stage actor, right? The word is made up of two different words, and the literal translation is interpreter for underneath. It refers to anyone who pretends to be someone they're not, wearing a figurative mask. So let me explain that a little bit more. So when we look at the origin of this word, especially in ancient Greece, it was used to describe someone who was an actor, right? A stage actor. These actors will wear these large masks over their face to show which characters they were playing in the plays. They will interpret the story from underneath their mask. And these masks were extremely important because it differentiated one person from the next. And as time went on, it referred to anyone who was wearing a figurative mask, pretending to be someone or something they were not. And so when Jesus, when he calls out the Pharisees and the scribes for being hypocrites, he's basically saying, "Say, hey, why are you putting on this mask, pretending to be righteous people, when in reality, you are not? You have these figurative masks pretending that you are righteous because you are obeying all these laws, right? All these human laws, but in your hearts, you are far from me, and you worship me in vain because you follow these human rules." And so legalism and hypocrisy takes account of this outward appearance, right? Putting on this figurative mask, but it does not take account of the heart. It does not take the inward beliefs and the convictions of a person. So according to this theology that the Pharisees and the scribes have, to be righteous and clean is observance of these outward rules, regulations, and traditions. And like I said, this is what they saw as religion. So someone can be serving God outwardly, but disobeying God inwardly in the heart. And that is the danger of legalism and hypocrisy. And that's the question that you need to be asking yourself this morning. Have you put on a figurative mask, obeying the religious traditions, rules, and regulations that we find in the church? Or have you fully committed yourself to God and gave your heart to God? All right, that's a question that you need to be real with yourself with. Have you put on a figurative mask? Because what we find is this: no amount of religion can ever make you righteous. No amount of religion can ever make you righteous. There's only one person who can make you righteous, and that is Jesus Christ. Only in Jesus Christ can you become righteous. Jesus doesn't want a religion with you. He wants a relationship with you. Jesus wants a relationship with you. Right? Jesus understood that it was only faith in him that makes a person clean. It is only faith in Jesus Christ and what he has done on the cross that makes you righteous. Right? As humans, we can never live up to God's standards. We can never live up to what God expects of us on our own. We will always fall short of God's expectations and his standards. Right? 2 Corinthians 5:21 says this: "God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God." Right? Achieving righteousness cannot happen on your own. And that was the biggest downfall of the Pharisees and the scribes. They believed that righteousness and being clean can be done on your own by obeying the laws. But it cannot happen. It can only happen in Jesus. And so that leads to my next point this morning. Jesus desires your heart, not religion. Jesus desires your heart, not religion. And so there's a person in the story that is David. David is called the person after God's own heart. And so when Samuel was sent to go look for the next king of Israel, listen to the words that God gives Samuel. It's found in 1 Samuel chapter 16, verse 7. "But the Lord said to Samuel, 'Do not consider his appearance or his height, for I have rejected him. The Lord does not look at the things people look at. People look at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart.'" Right? The Lord looks at the heart. Jesus looks beyond the outward appearance. Jesus can see your figurative mask that you have. Are you truly believing Jesus? Have you truly given your heart to Jesus Christ? Because if not, Jesus can see through that. Jesus can see through this figurative mask that you have. And so what exactly does it mean to give your heart to Jesus? What does it mean? And so we find that answer in Mark chapter 12, verses 28 through 31. And once again, it's the scribes interacting with Jesus, and it says this. One of the teachers of the law came and heard them debating. Noticing that Jesus had given them a good answer, he asked him, "Of all the commandments, which is the most important?" "The most important one," answered Jesus, "is this. Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God, the Lord is one. Love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your mind, and with all your strength. The second is this, love your neighbor as yourself. There is no commandment greater than these." And so what Jesus is doing here is absolutely amazing. Jesus is simplifying what it means to be a disciple and follower of Jesus Christ. Jesus is saying, I don't want a religion with you. I want a relationship with you. Love me with everything that you have. Love me with all your strength, with all your soul, with all your mind. And that is what it means to give your heart to Jesus. And it's so important that we do this as believers. Have you truly given your heart to God? Have you truly given everything that you have to Jesus? Because Jesus wants a relationship with you, not just you following a set of rules, regulations, and traditions. And then this leads to my final point this morning, right? And it is this. Transformation of the heart only happens in Jesus. Right? Transformation of the heart only happens in Jesus. When we go back to this story, we find out where sin originates from. And Jesus says this in towards the end, in verse 20 to 23. What comes out of a person is what defiles them. For it is from within, out of a person's heart, that evil thoughts come: sexual immorality, theft, murder, adultery, greed, malice, deceit, lewdness, envy, slander, arrogance, and folly. All these evil come from inside and defile a person. So Jesus, he wants us to give him his heart, our hearts, so he can transform our hearts. Jesus wants us to give us everything that he has, and in return, we give him everything that we have so he can transform us. Listen to Ezekiel chapter 36. For I will take you out of the nations. I will gather you from all the countries and bring you back into your own land. I will sprinkle clean water on you, and you will be clean. I will cleanse you from all your impurities and from all your idols. I will give you a new heart and put a new spirit in you. I will remove from you your heart of stone and give you a heart of flesh. And I will put my spirit in you and move you to follow my decrees and be careful to keep my laws. And so what is happening here is sanctification, right? Sanctification is just a fancy word that God is setting us apart and preparing us for his plans, right? Sanctification is the process in which God is preparing his followers to become more and more like Jesus. Right, it's a lifelong process. And Paul talks about this in 2 Corinthians. In chapter 4, he says this. Therefore, we do not lose heart. Though outwardly we are wasting away, yet inwardly we are being renewed day by day. For our light and momentary troubles are achieving for us an eternal glory that far outweighs them all. So we fix our eyes not on what is seen, but what is unseen, since what is seen is temporary, but what is seen is eternal. And then he talks about it some more in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. And he says this, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, the new creation has come. The old is gone, the new is here. That's the sanctification process in Jesus Christ. When you give your life to him, when you give your heart to him, you become transformed and the old you is gone and you is here in Jesus Christ. And remember what Jesus says, sin originates in the heart, and so when you hand over your heart to Jesus, he transforms your heart where you are no longer held to the power of sin, and you become able to overcome sin through what Jesus Christ has done, and he empowers you. And it is so important, because what the Pharisees and the scribes talked about was that the only way for you to become righteous or to become clean is following these human laws. But Jesus disagrees. Jesus says, come to me and I will make you righteous. Come to me and I will help you overcome your sins. Do not put on that figurative mask of being a hypocrite, but come to me and I will give you the ability to overcome sin. And how do we continuously live with Jesus? How do we continuously obey and be sanctified? It's by being in the Word of God. Listen to what Hebrews 4:12 says. For the Word of God is living and active, sharper than any two-edged sword, piercing to the division of soul and spirit, of joints and of marrow, and discerning the thoughts and intentions of the heart. The Word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. So who here, I want to do another little survey, but who here has ever read their Bible and was just like, ooh, all right, God, that kind of just pierced me right in the heart, right? Has that ever happened to anyone? Yeah, because the Word of God is living and is keeping you accountable. And so how do we continuously be transformed? It's by living in the Word of God and being in the presence of God through the Word. And we need to be careful about our hearts, because everything that we do comes out of our hearts. And this is one of my favorite Bible verses throughout the entire Bible, and it's Proverbs 4, chapter 4, verses 23. And it says this: above all else, guard your heart, for everything you do flows from it. And what's the best way to guard your heart? It's to give it to Jesus. When you give your heart to Jesus, it's in the best hands. God will protect you when you give your heart to Jesus. And so what's the most important thing that we can learn about this is that God cares about the heart of believers, and he wants your entire heart. And so are you willing to give your hearts to Jesus so he can take care of you? And let us pray. Heavenly Father, we just thank you for this wonderful day. We thank you that we get to be in your presence through worship, through the liturgy, through this message, and through communion today, Lord. We pray that we will get to encounter you more and more each day that we live. We pray that we will not be hypocrites or legalists, but that we will give our hearts to you, knowing that you are good and gracious, and that you are going to protect us, and that you are going to guard our hearts from all evil. And we pray all of this in the name of Jesus. Amen. And now I invite you to stand for our next hymn.
words, I believe, are some of the strongest words we can say. So let us share together what we believe in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to hell. On the third day, he rose again from the dead. He ascended to heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From there, he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Lord, we come before you today to present our tithes and offerings to you in faith. We believe your word, and we honor it by putting our faith in action through giving. We thank you for your blessing, and we believe we will have what you have promised. On this day of rejoicing, we pray for the life of the church, the world, and all in need. Heavenly Father, we come before you as a community, acknowledging the words of your Son. We ask for your help in seeking true purity of heart, rather than merely focusing on external appearances. Purify our hearts and minds and help us to reflect your love and righteousness in our actions. Teach us to value what you see within us rather than being swayed by human traditions or superficial measures. Guide us to live in alignment with your will, embracing the inner transformation you desire. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, as we meditate on today's gospel, we recognize that what truly defiles a person comes from within. We pray for the strength to confront and overcome the negative thoughts and behaviors that can take root in our hearts. Help us guard against the corruption that arises from within and seek your transforming power. Empower us to cultivate purity and integrity in our lives, reflecting your grace and truth in all that we do. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Gracious God, we ask your Spirit to work mightily within us, transforming our hearts and minds. Remove from us any attitudes or actions that are displeasing to you, and replace them with your fruits of the Spirit. Fill us with love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Let our lives be a testament to your redemptive work, manifesting your Spirit in all our interactions and reflecting the true nature of your kingdom. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Joining our voices with your faithful ones in every time and place, we offer our prayers in the name of the risen one, Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise. And on the night in which he was betrayed, our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, he took the bread, he gave thanks, and he broke it. And he gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat. This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And again, after the supper, he took the cup, and he gave thanks, and he gave it to all to drink, saying, "This cup is my new covenant in my blood, shed for you for the forgiveness of sins for all people. Do this in remembrance of me." Hear us now as we pray the prayer that our resurrected Lord taught us to pray, saying, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen."
Come to the banquet, for all is now ready. You may be seated. Thank you. Please stand. Let us pray. God of abundance, with this bread of life and cup of salvation, you have united us with Christ, making us one with all your people. Now send us forth in the power of your Spirit, that we may proclaim your redeeming love to the world and continue forever in the risen life of Jesus Christ our Lord.
Amen.
And now receive today's benediction. God, who gives life to all things and frees us from despair, bless you with truth and peace, and may the Holy Trinity, one God, guide you always in faith, hope, and love.
Amen.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.